My name is Peter Owen Jones. I'm a lucky man. I live in the beautiful Sussex countryside. And I'm the vicar of three parishes.
And you may kiss the bride passionately.
But a year ago, I was beginning to feel worn down by the rat race. I yearned for a simpler, more meaningful existence. I found an unlikely answer in the example of the 13th century saint, Francis of Assisi. He gave up using money. Could I follow in his footsteps? I began by growing my own veg, foraging and raising hens.
How fantastic is that?
I bartered my labour for necessities.
Yeah. I think you probably earned a bit more.
But self-sufficiency wasn't the answer to a simple life. A Franciscan friar told me why.
Franciscan poverty isn't about self-sufficiency. Our poverty says to the world, I'm going to allow God to provide all that I need through other people.
To test this, I decided to go on the road without money and throw myself at the mercy of total strangers.
Thank you. That is so kind.
My experiences gave me a glimpse of a better way of life.
Are you sure, Mike?
I am.
I'm really touched.
Now I'm back in my parishes, facing a fresh new challenge. Can I apply the lessons of my road trip here at home?
Do you want some grapes?
And can I do it without using money? Is a simple life just a fantasy, or might it be really within my reach? I've been trying to live a simpler, more meaningful life since the spring of last year.
Okay, has everyone got one of these?
I've kept up my job as a part-time vicar, which gives me my house and pays some of my utility bills.
Michael.
But direct payments to me by the BBC have been put on hold, leaving me completely cashless. In the autumn, I decided to leave the comfort of my parishes. Following the example of St. Francis of Assisi, I took to the road for 2 weeks without money. I had to beg for food and a bed from complete strangers.
I wondered if I could sleep in your little shed.
It was daunting.
I think this is the bit I'm least looking forward to. I wondered if you'd buy me just a little bit of cheese.
Go on then.
Often rejected.
Excuse me, madam. Hello?
I put myself in the hands of fate.
What a day.
But out of that test came something unexpected. Welcome. People did put me up for the night. And they did feed me. And I was able to give back in return.
And if I can do someone a good turn, then that's a good thing.
Even if it was just my time.
Are we going to say some grace?
Let's say some grace. The road trip has been an extraordinary experience.
Myrtle.
Myrtle.
But its effect doesn't really sink in until I'm back home and my friend Helen Bazzard drops by.
Hi, Pete, it's me.
Hiya.
How are you?
I'm all right, I brought you a couple of logs.
Logs?
As a psychotherapist, she's been anxious about the wisdom of my experiment and wants to know how it went. It's only then that it really hit me.
Pete, I haven't seen you for ages. The last time I saw you was before you went out on the road.
Mm.
But how was it out there?
Well, it's reducing me to tears already. It was incredible. Because of people's incredible kindness, and that when it mattered, and it really mattered out there because you're very vulnerable, yeah. Somehow or other, people came through.
Maybe that it's actually about allowing other people to be at their best.
The moment someone says yes, you can sleep in the caravan, you can sleep in the barn, would you like some food? Everything changes. At that moment, everything changes. That moment of giving.
Have you yet a sense of how you may bring that back into the village, the parishes?
Give.
Give.
I've just got to give. More.
Give more.
Much more. More of what I have, more of my time. I've just got to be much more open. If giving is the road to a simple life, what can I give to the people of my parishes? And can I carry on doing so without using money? The simplest thing I can give is my time. So when Richard, a local parishioner, asks for help cutting his hedge, I don't hesitate. I go and give him a hand. I'm used to good old-fashioned shears, but Richard suggests a more modern approach.
Morning. Lovely day. Look, mine are bigger than yours, mate.
Well, I have got the electric ones.
Right, then.
Are you happy to use it?
I'm happy to use it, yeah.
You've got a power breaker on.
Well, I'll put myself in the hands of the Lord, I think.
Well, it's already there for you. Don't cut the cable.
I'm not meant to cut the cable.
No, don't cut the cable.
All right.
He said to me, can you come and cut my hedge? And of course, I can come and cut my hedge. And it's a delight. In a sense, it's a great opportunity for me to just be here and chat.
How's that?
That's absolutely fine.
Just, yeah?
Yes, a good trim.
Yeah?
You won't ruin it, so don't worry. I'll be...
Is that a statement of confidence?
Yes.
What I'm beginning to understand is that we don't actually feel comfortable expressing our needs to other people. Because we've got money, we go out and we think we can take care of that ourselves. It's through that expressing of need that we get to know each other. There we are.
That's jolly nice, isn't it?
It's not bad, is it?
It's good. You better go and get your goodie box now.
Goodie box? Have I got a goodie box?
Well, I think probably you have.
Oh!
Hey, oh! Gee! Look, there's a gentleman here.
Reward.
My reward?
Yep.
Oh, how sweet of you.
Thank make
you.
His hair curl.
Make my hair curl?
Yes.
A
bit of fruit would be better for you than chocolate peanuts, I thought.
How right you are. How right you are.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye. Okay, see you. I've helped out and I've got some supplies in return. I've also spent quality time with a parishioner. But it won't do just to cut hedges. I'd like to give something back to the whole community.
Oh, look at that.
And ever since my return, that's become a matter of some urgency. Gifts have been left by my parishioners.
Curried parsnip soup. Who's that from?
Gordon Bennett.
And what started as a trickle has built into a tidal wave.
Okay, this has arrived in the last 24 hours. These came this morning. Gluten-free mince pies and a gluten-free black cherry and chocolate cake. This arrived yesterday. It's a big cake. The longer this has gone on, the more generous people in these lovely villages have been, because everyone's getting the hang of it now. And I mean, it's a real testament to the fact that you can live the Franciscan way. It's worked. It has worked.
Two dead ducks. The art of giving hasn't just caught on, it's spread like wildfire.
I'm being fed, and some parishioners are even putting petrol in my car. I want to return their kindness. And at last, my Franciscan way of life gives me the chance. Working 2 days a week as a part-time vicar is not normally conducive to pastoral care. I have 16 hours a week to service the parishes, and then for the other time, I'm meant to be making a living. You know, visiting becomes incredibly difficult. And one of the main things which suffers is, sadly, pastoral care. But now, released from the burden of making money, I have much more time to give my parishioners. But the Franciscan model means that because I'm digging people's gardens, cutting their hedges, helping out here and there, that I'm there. And that's what I've really enjoyed.
Do you like that?
I like that. I like that a lot. Whether they like it a lot, of course, is another matter. The elderly are at the top of my list. Dog alert, dog alert. Hello, darling, how are you? God, it's occupational hazard of being a vicar. One of my close neighbours, Joyce, is the oldest person in the parish. Hello, my dear. How are you?
I'm better, thank you. Yeah? I'm feeling better myself.
You're feeling better?
Thank you.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
I've just got you some dams and jam.
Oh, have you? Oh, you shouldn't.
No, well, I mean, I picked a whole load in the autumn.
Did
and I've made a whole load.
Oh, you are good. And biscuit?
Oh, why not? Let's have a biscuit. Nowadays, sadly, very few rural vicars can spare this sort of time. But visiting is one of the most rewarding aspects of being a vicar.
So the secret of life is to get on with people.
I think it is.
Yeah.
And what do you think? I mean, we love can't live everybody.
No.
But the most important ones you love.
Yes.
Don't you think?
Yes, I agree with you. I mean, it's...
All this extra time for ministry is great. But it's dependent on 24-hour access to my car.
There was an interesting situation on the weekend. I got a call after I finished washing up in the public house, and I had to go. Then and there, there was no question about it. And if I hadn't have had this car, then I wouldn't have been able to get there.
Until now, living without money hasn't been a big problem. I barter my labour for the things I need.
Good, thank you.
And top.
My friend Loz has landed a job rebuilding a flint wall in a nearby village. And he's asked me to help him out in exchange for a Christmas tree.
Like a dentist, so he's basically taken all the rot off the top.
Okay.
Flint work is a pretty specialised job. Best left, I think, to the experts.
I've done builder's labouring when I was a lad, but this is much more of a skilled job.
I stick to the labouring jobs. Cleaning and shifting old bricks.
That's it. So I use this barrow. I'm not going to fill it too full.
No, I won't move it. Loz has to check out another job, so he leaves me in charge for an hour. And that's when things don't go quite as planned.
Oh no, I've broken the barrow. If I had cash, I'd say, well, look, of course, I'll replace it. But because I don't have cash, it makes life a great deal more complicated. And I've got to tell Lawrence when he gets back.
Hi.
Hi. Well, I was getting on very well. But I'm afraid I have broken your barrow. I'm so sorry. Just out of interest, how much are they? Do you remember?
Well,
about 80 quid, 90 quid?
No, less than that. I think it was about... Oh, no, actually, I think it might have been about that much.
Yeah. Okay.
I have a horrible feeling it was probably about 100. But,
Yeah, that is a horrible feeling.
That barrow is quite precious to me, so it's like, oh, no, the worst possible situation. But, Oh, here's the boss.
Hello. Building inspector is late.
Oh, they always are, I suppose, aren't they?
Keep going.
The vicar's feeling terrible.
Why?
Well, you know what I said about the wheelbarrow, being a bit fragile.
What have you bust?
Bust the barrow, mate.
I feel terrible, but...
No. None of you must feel terrible.
It's actually my fault, probably, for not supplying the right equipment.
No. It's my fault for being stupid and lobbing stuff in there when I should have really known better. Lord seems to want to take the blame and cover the bill for my expensive mistake. He says, don't worry about it, Pete. But, you know, he's getting married. Needs cash. Doesn't need some idiot coming along breaking a barrow. I'm not happy about it. Without money, I feel completely helpless. But there must be something I can do to compensate him. Next day, I look for a solution to Barrowgate. On your wedding day, I pick you up.
You really are bartering now, aren't you?
I'm bartering, mate.
Yeah? Go on.
No, let me have a think. I'm racking my brains to think if I have anything of value. And then I remember.
What have you got there?
For the lamb, for the vicar.
Is this the lamb that I've earned?
Well, you've definitely earned it.
Yeah.
I think you've probably earned a bit more than this, actually.
Okay, mate. I earned some lamb working for my friend Andrew. Perhaps that would do. I have an idea. Do you like South Down lamb?
Yeah. I love lamb, full stop.
If I gave you half a lamb,
yeah,
butchered, all done, in exchange for the barrow.
Okay. That's a deal.
All right.
That's a deal,
done.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah? That'd be fantastic, mate. All right, thanks, Loz. I'm really pleased to have covered the bill without using money. Loz has a stack of his favourite meat, and I've stayed true to my Franciscan ideals. I'm just left with a niggling feeling. Was Loz really happy with the arrangement? Overall, I sense my life has slowed down. I can enjoy the late autumn fruits of the hedgerows. They're a bit sharp. Yeah, they're a bit sharp. Even stand and idly chat with my friend and skeptic, Pete the Taxi.
One that you can't hide, Vicar.
Oh, it's a lovely day, actually gorgeous, isn't it? Is it nice with the clouds on the hills too?
Beautiful. Do you like living here?
Yes, but you do get used to it. It's nice, like, if you go on holiday down Devon, you think, oh, wonderful sight, but you don't seem to realise it's on your own doorstep as well, do you?
No.
You tend to miss it. You have to stop and look and listen, don't you?
You do.
Enjoy it, appreciate it more.
Yeah, you do.
Yes.
Right, mate. I better get on.
Yes, better get on. We'll probably see you around the corner sometime.
I will. See you. Happy days.
Go on, Uncle.
Isn't this what life was made for? But it's November, and my experiment ends in the new year. If a simple life is all about giving, I need to give more than routine parish visits. I've got very little time to come up with something big.
One of my parishes, Beddingham Church, is going through a major facelift. And that sparks the germ of an idea. The asbestos-laden organ has to be taken out for safety reasons.
Yeah, it is. It's going to be heavy.
One of my parishioners, Mel, a carpenter, is overseeing the removal of the ancient structure. She's having a lot of fun doing it.
The clangers, isn't it?
My parishioners worked incredibly hard to raise over £10,000 to foot the restoration bill. Their monumental effort is inspiring a brand new thought. This church sits on a crossroads, a very busy crossroads. So I thought, when the work is complete, I would start some drive-by services on a Thursday rush hour in the evening. To see how they go, really. Just 20 minutes for people just to sort of calm down after a day at work. So probably a couple of weeks before Christmas, I'll get those going. And I'll put some notices out there and see if anyone comes. This is new time. I could freely give over and above my regular parish duties. But for the moment, the plan needs to take a back seat. My mission to live without money is in real jeopardy. The MOT on my aged Astra motor car is due, and the car is indispensable for my work. This could be a disaster.
MOT?
MOT, there she is.
It's all right. Missing wing mirror.
£50.
Roughly.
And then how long do they take to order?
10 minutes.
Yeah, it's not a problem. I mean, it takes 5 minutes literally to fit. 10 minutes tops.
Yeah.
How many miles have
I got, Pete? Where am I on now? I'm on 129,000.
Oh, OK. That's all right. That'd be well within, so...
Maybe you should do a programme about having no money and everything.
I mean, yeah.
Oh, it's a bit of a question about the old... No, never mind.
No, go on, far away.
No. How are you going to pay for the car then?
While I'm waiting, I take a stroll into Lewis, pondering the outcome. If there are problems, could I delay paying for a few weeks until the experiment is over? And now that Christmas is coming, will I get through that without cash?
That's your failure, mate. It does go on a little bit.
I was going to say, that
yeah,
looks like
quite...
it's
a bit heavy.
Go on, then.
That's a wing mirror, we know about that.
Yeah.
It's not a problem. Windscreen wiper. Offside front under bonnet brake pipe is excessively corroded. The offside inner wheel arch is excessively corroded. Offside rear outer seat. So yeah, it's quite a lot. I mean, it's a fair bit of welding.
Anything else?
Is there any? If you could leave it with me.
I just need to know what the final figure might be in the region of.
I would say in the region of about £300.
Yeah, okay, mate.
Is that all right?
That's fine. I mean, I've got to take it away now. But
of course, yeah.
Can
yeah.
I give you a call? And
yeah, you're more than welcome to sleep rough down here. While
okay.
For it's no problem.
Cheers, mate.
There,
yeah. So. Oh, I was noticing how comfortable that bench looked.
There you go, bud.
Cheers, mate.
That's all right.
All right.
No problem.
See ya.
Take care.
I'll see you soon.
Thanks, mate. Yes, you
Bye.
Will. See you later.
You know, 300 with a bit of fat. All the other stuff that needs doing, the advisory stuff, 600. And look, she's overheating now, just 10 minutes in traffic. I don't know what to do. The last thing I want is to start using money again, with the end so near. I'm going to talk it over with David Alcorn, one of my parishioners. he's kindly invited me to dinner at his house. He helped to raise the £10,000 for the Beddingham Church restoration. As a businessman and wine bar owner, he's always been sceptical about the value of my experiment. David loves the good things in life, so I give him a special bottle I've had tucked away under the stairs for years.
Can't beat a bit of that.
But I know he won't let me off lightly.
So how are you?
Yeah, I'm thinner. How are you?
Well, I'm fatter. Is it over now? Have you done it all?
I'm sort of reaching a critical point in terms of some dilemmas.
Right.
Most noticeably my MOT.
Okay.
And my car insurance.
Right.
Which I can't really barter for. All I've got left, my really big barter chips, are half a lamb, but I broke someone's wheelbarrow.
So that means Shanks his pony for a while.
I need the car. Especially if I get an emergency call in the middle of the night.
Good. Take as much as you would like, just in case nobody leaves anything on your doorstep this week.
Thanks, mate.
I hope you like the burgundy.
It's marvellous.
It's a little 2000 from Volney. You can't do anything without money. I mean, we can all pretend that we're jolly, jolly happy with threepence in our pocket, but we're not, because I think everybody needs a little bit of ritziness or excitement in their lives from time to time, you know.
Aren't wealthy lifestyles taking more from the planet? Are we not taking
more? No, I disagree with that. It is really unrealistic to say that you don't need money at all.
Oh, no,
I mean, everything's money, if you think about it. It has to be. But no. That's reality. That is reality.
David has a point. But I'm not ready to abandon the rule of St. Francis quite yet. My simple life is being stretched to the limit, and not just by the big bills which are stacking up. My attempt at the good life is also unravelling. The chicken run has served me well, but now my most prized lair has been snatched away.
The fox found the one hen that I can't get in at night. He found her over there, brought her round, dispatched her here, I would imagine, and then jumped over the wall, taken her back up onto the dance and consumed her.
My problems are becoming a deluge. This time it's the car insurance. It was due yesterday. Unlike the MOT, I cannot put this one off.
How much is it? £164.48. If I asked a couple of people, they might pay it, actually. And for me here, asking someone to give me £164.48 is too far. That's, for me, too far. Money. I can't escape from the hold that it has on the way in which we organise what we do. Okay. May I have my wallet back, please? Mm-hmm.
James? I'll go and get it.
All right, mate. I just feel rather sad at this point, actually. It does feel a bit like a defeat, that the system's finally got me. I don't think I've got a choice there anymore. Go on, then. Oh, hi, Liam. You've given me a quote of £164.48. I'd like to pay that now, please. What? Why is it 177 now? Because it's a day after the renewal date. But I'm still renewing it. Well, that is just really cheeky, really. That's just sharp, mate. That's just sharp. Okay, let's do it then. Let's do it.
Scrounging now.
Don't even go there. Don't
even. Why are you scrounging? Go on.
The last thing I need today is an accusation of scrounging from Pete the taxi. At my usual Friday kitchen job at the pub, I can't bring myself to tell the chefs about my decision. They've all been so incredibly supportive.
Your box up there, that way.
My box?
Yeah.
Oh, is that, you'd be keeping that for me?
I couldn't fit any more in it, so I...
They've even kept a box of scraps for my cat and my chickens. Am I letting them all down?
Is it getting harder or is it getting easier?
The kitchen banter makes things worse.
Do you think money makes you happy?
I don't think money makes you happy.
At all?
No. I think happiness is a state of mind.
And my guilty secret means I'm not at all happy.
There we are. See you, mate.
Cheers,
babe. All right.
Telling them was too much an admission of failure. But soon I may have no choice.
Look at this. Mince pies. Giant marrow fat processed peas. Oh, shepherd's pie. And I haven't looked in here. Oh, and a lovely cake. It just keeps coming. Which is wonderful. But I've got to try and sort of calm it down now, really.
I decide to go public with Amy at the village shop. Soon, everyone will know.
How are you?
I'm very well, thank you, Pete. How are you?
Yeah, good.
Good. Can I help you? You're not pointing your smile, are you? You're not asking your smile.
I'm afraid it's come to the
end. It's real money.
It's real money.
So, what would you like?
20 pounds. Yeah, £20. It's actually, I caved in last night because I had to pay my car insurance.
Oh, dear. Okay. So. You can't live without money after all, then.
No, you can't. You can't live without money. It's just what we do with it, I think, that is important. Approved.
But you have your money back to civilization.
Or not civilization.
I can't deny it's a blow. With just a few weeks to go, I've been forced to use money again.
Lovely crab apples on the downs. Lovely, lovely.
But my Franciscan experiment has taught me a great deal about what matters. So I'm not giving up on a simple life just yet. The question for me now, actually for all of us, is whether there's a third way. Is it really possible to use money and still keep life in a healthy balance? I'm going to give it a go. That night, I get on with my big idea for Beddingham Church. It's to offer my time in a different way. And I'm using my old skills as an advertising copywriter to do it.
Oh, that's it. Yeah. Beat the Christmas rush. Hello.
Mikey, the local sign writer, is going to print them up for me.
I'm going to start some services, some rush hour services outside Bellingham Church.
Right.
So these signs are to go up, and then commuters hopefully will see them and think, that's a really good idea, or they might not.
Mm.
I decide to visit my friend Mel, the carpenter, restoring Beddingham Church, for some advice. She too lived without money, as a Buddhist nun, but for an incredible 11 years. How did she manage going back to using it?
Having handled it again. Yeah, I can. It's, right. It's like feeling the weight of it.
It's sticky.
Yeah. And it weighs a lot.
Well, it's either yours or someone else's by its very nature. It has to belong to someone. So it's, you know, it has a lot of ego attachment to it wherever it goes. Yeah. It doesn't exist outside of that.
No.
But I don't see it as necessarily a tainted thing of itself. But I mean, we're talking in very abstract terms here.
Sure.
It's just an exchange. But
yeah, essentially what you're saying is rather than demonize money, if some spiritual values were to be invested, within that system, then that's very different from spending it, just having it and spending it.
Having it as a resource and knowing how to use it rather than it use us, because too often it turns the other way around and it becomes an end in itself.
Yeah.
With Mel's wise and hopeful words still ringing in my ears, I'm off to Lewis to put her advice to the test.
When I come into town, I've just got to get stuff that I need, not engage with all of these delightful things placed in windows to get my attention. I've just got to be strong and say, I just need bin bag liners, a waterproof hat, some screws, and some candles. And that is it. Hi there.
Things start off quite well.
Recycled plastic bananas.
I avoid frivolous snacks.
Oh, look. I wish I hadn't have seen those. That was close.
Sidestep the lure of my favourite antique shop.
Oh, no, I can't. Come on, I can't do it.
I try and stick to the essentials. I show an unhealthy interest in screws.
Here I am back in the high street spending money. Really, I mean, it's just like getting back on a bicycle. It's not a big deal. You just get on with it.
But the boredom is killing me. And when I pass a much-loved record shop, I crack.
How are you? Have you heard of a singer called Bob Amos?
He's a lot.
See if he's on the computer.
Just at my name.
Could I order it?
CDs are my weakness.
And I'll let you know when it comes in.
Yeah, do you want me to settle up now?
No.
You sure?
Yeah, no, keep your money just that little bit longer.
Well, thank you.
The truth is, with Christmas in full swing, temptation is all around me. At every corner, we're being asked to spend money we don't have on things we don't need.
Happy Christmas!
It makes me quite angry. Our time here is precious and short. Too short to be squandered on the pursuit of materialism.
Nothing like a storm to clear your head.
I'm fired up, and it's on days like this, faced by the raw power of nature, that I find inspiration for my sermons. And I want to share my thoughts this Sunday with everyone in church. I wonder how it'll go down.
We are not loving our neighbours as ourselves. Most of us spend an inordinate time working and walking round in our own little bubbles, believing that life would be a good deal more simple if I just had what I wanted. What is the purpose of these 70 years? Is it just this mad dash to acquire possessions, power, control? Or are we here to create peace, harmony, and generosity?
The problem is I. And nothing can change until we move to we. That is what will change things. Okay. Thank you all very much for coming. It was lovely to see you. Come on, let's sing our last hymn. Thank you for my lovely pie.
That's okay, you're very welcome.
Thank you.
I didn't quite get round your sermon today.
You didn't get round my sermon today?
No.
I was just trying to say that if we attach ourselves to believing that in this short life, if we just regard it as a race to acquire as much stuff as possible, then we're going to miss the point.
Yeah, I think I missed it.
You haven't missed it.
Thank you, Peter.
See ya.
Thank
you. See ya.
Hats on.
Perhaps it was arrogance of me to expect everyone to understand. And speaking of arrogance, in my quest to find a new balance, I'm reminded of my debt to Loz and that niggling feeling about the wheelbarrow and the lamb.
Okay, mate, I'll see you then. Bye now.
I don't know how much the wheelbarrow costs. Maybe he's had to shell out a great deal more than the value of half a lamb. So I want to find out from him, you know, has he been shortchanged? Have I been shortchanged? Would he rather have the cash? Since now, I've got it. Would that help him more than half a lamb? Was he being kind just by saying, okay, Pete, yeah, half a lamb will do, when thinking, I really would rather have the cash? Nozzy, how are you, mate?
Fine, thank you.
You all right?
Yeah, not too bad. Thanks.
Good.
Ah, how's that, mate? Good.
But yeah, both of us, I think, had quite big nights. Do you want a cup of tea?
Love one, yeah.
Look, mate, I've got my wallet back, and it's a straight question.
Right.
Would you rather have the lamb or the cash?
I'd rather have the lamb.
Yeah.
But I'd probably need the cash.
You need
a little bit
more. Okay, mate. Have I put sugar in there?
Yeah.
Did I do it?
You did, yeah.
Okay, mate.
Ordinarily, it wouldn't be so much of a problem, but as you know, it's been a bit of a tricky year, so.
It has. It's been a tricky year for everyone. Are we talking thousands or hundreds for a yard barrow? How much is it, mate?
I think it was about £120.
Okay, I will sort that out for you down the road.
It's funny how, like, a good deed can...
It's funny how
spin around.
Exactly.
Stand on its head.
A good deed can turn around and bite you on the arse.
Yeah.
Yeah. But there we are. Right,
20, 40, 60, 80, 90, 100.
Okay. Thanks. That's great. Lovely day. What a lovely day. Right, mate. Here we are. 100. 115. 120.
Thank you very much.
Pounds.
Thank you.
No worries, mate.
Thank you, Pete.
All right, mate.
My signs have arrived just in time for the launch of the rush hour services. But my project is up against formidable forces.
Our time now. Everyone is after it. The advertisers want our attention. Our family needs our attention. Our school needs our attention. Charities need our attention. The church wants our attention. It's constantly, you know, this constant battle for our attention. And I somehow get caught up in all of that. What I'm hoping for is that, you know, someone, one or two people driving past might say, oh, 20 minutes, just... when no one is expecting anything of me, where I can just breathe out just for 20 minutes in the middle of this mad bum fight called Christmas. And that's what I can give. I'm in a position to give that.
It's be quiet rather than quiet, please.
Oh no.
They're all bloody wrong. 20 minutes. The most important word in all of this is quiet. And we haven't quite got there on that front.
What are you gonna do?
I'm gonna have to cancel tonight's quiet meditation and prayer and go for a quiet meditation and prayer next Monday or Tuesday, I think. I just pray the services themselves will work out. Still, for all the setbacks, the key to a better balance is to learn from one's mistakes. I've got further problems with my chickens. The fox has been again, leaving one solitary hen. But this time I'm building an escape-proof pen. And wiser and thinner, I know better now than to turn down help. My friend Pete offers to find replacement chickens. In return, I'll dig his allotment.
Cash in the attic. Oh, Vicar, hello. So, Jordan, could you pop in?
Is he delivering them here?
Yes, but they've got some cockerels as well, which I don't think he'll want all them cockerels.
I won't take a cockerel without some hens.
No.
I don't mean to be picky.
What? No, you can't have a cockerel without hens.
No. Are these your eggs? Are they still laying?
Yeah, we've got four today.
God, that's fantastic. I haven't had anything off mine for about...
You've only got one?
Well, I was hoping she might be a little more productive than she's currently been.
She's probably lonely, Peter. Do you want a cup of tea while you're here?
I'm all right, thanks, mate. That's really sweet of you.
Pete arranges for me to pick up a cockerel and three hens in a week's time.
Yeah, that's fine. OK, cheers, then.
Sweet of you, mate. Sweet of you.
All right.
Okay.
See you later.
Whether I really can balance money with self-sufficiency, bartering, and the help of others, only time will tell. But I am optimistic. I remember that right under my nose, there are people who have already carved out a more simple life for themselves. One villager is the queen of downsizing.
There she is, she got the wood burner going.
My friend Diane, who grew up in the village, now lives locally in a van. She uses money and lives a simple life. I've never really asked her why she does it or how she manages.
Yes. Is that your new stove?
Yes, it is, yeah.
Look at that.
Works well.
Yeah, it does. What's it about this way of life?
You don't totally get away from the system, but it is a freedom from the system in a way. As you can see, I don't have, you know, the white goods that other people have.
I mean, you have a bed.
Yeah.
A cooker, a stove, fridge.
Mm-hmm. I've got my MP3 player.
You've got your MP3 player. And you've got warmth and shelter and food.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Why is it, do you think, that you need this and other people need 8-bedroom houses with swimming pools and tennis courts? What's all that about?
Well, that's the difference between need and want, isn't it?
Hmm.
I can go into people's houses and I can think, well, yep, that is lovely, but I don't want it. I spend my time doing other things, walking, painting, and doing whatever I like. And the van acts as a hide, and it's incredible how much nature that you can actually see. Foxes and badgers are pottering around outside. It's amazing, really.
That's lovely. Little goldfinch.
On alder.
Alder.
All the bing-bongs and the flowers.
In this amount of detail, it's like a meditation.
It is, it is.
We don't ever consider that by using less, we might actually have more time to do and be who we want to be. And you've done it.
I have, haven't I?
You have, mate.
Hmm.
You have. But you've sort of turned the whole theory upside down. All we need to do is to want less, and then we'll have more time.
Yes.
You got a pension?
No. No. Of course I haven't got a pension. No. You know who he is?
He is the Grim One. That's quite a dark piece, that.
That
one.
Is.
I mean, I like him.
You do?
Because we all need to face him at some point.
I think time goes by so quickly.
Mm.
And you can never get it back.
Time. Maybe that's the way to a meaningful life. Diane's right. We should make the most of it. Our lives are indeed so brief. And that's got me thinking. I know I can give more of my time to the parish, but what about the natural world? I feed off its bounty. So what can I give back?
A seed for next year. Look at that.
Well, as a priest, I'm closely involved with funerals. The deceased of my parishes are often buried in the church graveyards. We live and die seeking monuments to our earthly conquests, and our endeavours so often seem to take from, rather than to give back to, nature. It's my job to read the last rites, but I think I could offer something more. A kinder, humbler, more Franciscan way of death. Not far from my parishes, there's a field. I'd like it to become a woodland burial site. The thing about woodland burial is that it celebrates our relationship with the earth in a way that conventional burial can't do. The American model of burial, for instance, places, you know, lines up dignity with money. So if you're spending a great deal on your very fancy coffin, then that must mean you've had a successful life and that you are well considered. This model is the complete antithesis to that. This model is about spending as less as possible, not as much as possible. Anyway, look, it's going to be lovely. We've got a plant so that we can still see the view. I mean, wonderful. We've got the Long Man of Wilmington there. And then you come round and then you've got Fell Beacon over there. Francis treated the earth as sort of a family member and really understood that when we call earth mother, he treated her as mother, as Christ treated God as father. And it was that which was so revolutionary, but it's prophetic in terms of what we need to understand about our future. With Christmas just around the corner, I can at last make good my promise to give commuters a quiet break. I've spent nearly a year out of the rat race. Will anyone else want to join me for just 20 minutes?
Well, there we are. They're all driving past. Lots of people would say, well, it's horrible. This church is stuck on a roundabout between the A26 and the A27. But that's what it's got going for it. I've just got to find a way of quietly encouraging people to step outside of all of that for 20 minutes, 25 minutes a week. And just come and try and get a bit of balance to the crazy lives that we all live. and Vickers lead crazy lives as well. Hello?
Which way? That way, then.
One lonely soul. And the idiot vicar.
It's definitely not the most auspicious start to a rush hour service, but it's the culmination of a long journey, which has taught me a lot.
Let's begin. Let the noise in our heads go. Place to heal. Place to begin and a place to end. Try and find some space. Some silence. In the midst of our busy lives. The lessons that I've learned is that I have to want less. And what St. Francis gave me was an opportunity to step off that conveyor belt. And I loved it. When I started my quest last spring, all I wanted was to get out of the rat race and to live a more fulfilling life. I never imagined where it would take me. Living without money brought me closer to the land. On the road, I learned how generosity brings you closer to people. Back home, I realized I can use money and live a more balanced, simpler life. I've learned that we all need a bit of humility in our lives. We shouldn't be afraid to let others know what our needs are. And we should give back with the same generous heart. In short, I have felt so much more connected with everyone in these wonderful villages that I serve. It was packed.
And I think I see why the act of giving was so precious to St. Francis. He believed that life itself was a gift from God, the very fountain of meaning. He would have wanted us to celebrate this. And I'm happy to do just that.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us. Within our homes, this Christmas time. Amen. Amen.
It's comedy next tonight. Frank Skinner's opinionated and he's in Glasgow. Next on BBC Two.